Penguin Random House Audio presents The Boy Who Runs, The Odyssey of Julius Achon, by John Brant. Read for you by Fred Sanders. Pause, you who read this, and think for a moment of the long chain of iron or gold, of thorns or flowers, that would never have bound you, but for the formation of the first link on one memorable day. Charles Dickens. Great Expectations. Julius Achon almost sat out the biggest race of his life. It was early May 1996, and Julius was preparing for the NCAA Track and Field Championships. They were going to be held at the end of June, and he was favored to win both the 800 and 1500 meters. In anticipation, he engaged in a teardown phase of training. When a middle-distance runner trashes his muscle fibers and drains his glycogen stores before building them back up for the big event. John Cook, the George Mason University coach, drove Julius through taxing days of drills, sprints, and strength training sessions. By design, the heavy work temporarily dulled his edge for racing. Following convention, Cook decided to hold his prized athlete out of a low-stakes conference meet that GMU was hosting the next weekend. On Thursday, 2 days before the meet, Cook put Julius through an especially searing workout. 20 repetitions of 200 meters, each rep run at a full tilt 26-plus seconds, with an almost sadistically scant 45 seconds of rest between each rep. Afterward, Julius staggered back to the apartment he shared with a few other foreign runners. Mattresses and box springs lay flush on the floor, ranks of training shoes waited by the door, and a pot of rice and beans simmered on the stove. He grabbed some ice for his legs, flopped down on the couch, and was just drifting off to sleep when the phone rang. It was Coach Cook. "Chief?" For some reason, he always called Julius Chief. "I've been reconsidering. How do you feel about running the 800 on Saturday?" How did Julius feel? As a boy in his native Uganda, during his forced servitude in the Lord's Resistance Army, his rebel commander often whipped him with a switch fashioned from a tree limb. His present pain recalled those beatings. "I don't know," he replied carefully. "I'm pretty fried, Coach." "That's fine. I don't expect any fireworks. Look, we need the points," Cook continued. "You could finish fourth in the 800. That's 3 points if you did fucking backflips the whole way." Julius understood that Cook wasn't asking him to run. He was telling him to. "Coach, you don't have to cuss." "Thanks for this, Chief. I owe you one." "Come to church with us on Sunday, Coach." "No way, Chief. I'll never owe you that much." So Julius towed the line of the 800 meters. Deep-chested and rope-muscled, he resembled a middleweight prize fighter more than a middle-distance runner. 3 faint parallel lines scarring his cheeks, the product of a witch doctor ritual in his childhood, contributed to the warrior effect. He ran with a stride at once flawless and electric. His hardened feet, only recently sheathed by training and racing shoes, clawing the track surface like a leopard's paws. Julius possessed the strength to lead a race from wire to wire and the speed to win with a devastating final kick. In bearing and aspect, he seemed mature as a king. Yet Julius was only 19 years old. His future appeared limitless. Today, though, no magic was likely. Due to the recent grinding labor, Julius felt like he was wearing a 40-pound vest. After the first lap of the 2-lap race, he was running dead last. Midway through the second lap, with just 200 meters to go, he remained buried at the back of the pack. It appeared that Julius would fail to deliver any points for his team. Then something happened. By habit, Julius stepped to an outside lane, gaining position to launch his kick. And somehow, he started passing people. Normally a fiercely focused competitor, Julius felt oddly detached, as if he were standing by the side of the track, watching himself accelerate. Rounding the final turn, with 150 meters to go, he still trailed five runners. But an eye blink later, with 100 meters remaining, the path ahead had magically cleared. To his own amazement, Julius had seized the lead. In fact, the gap was 10 yards and growing. He wasn't running. He was floating. He couldn't feel his legs. He moved in slow motion, swaddled in a cone of effortless silence. Later, he would marvel that it felt so easy. Julius glided across the finish. He slowed to a stop, laced his fingers together behind his head, and cast a reluctant eye at the digital race clock. But the numbers on the clock made no sense. He wasn't even supposed to run in the race, so how could... His thoughts were interrupted because his teammates were rushing toward him, and across the infield, Coach Cook couldn't stop grinning. Today, during the presentations he gives around the world as head of the Achon Uganda Children's Fund, Julius talks sparingly about his world-class athletic career. More often, he engages his audiences with accounts of Uganda and its anguish, his escape from the LRA under a rain of machine gun fire, the morning he discovered 11 orphaned children lying underneath a bus. But in many ways, that race exemplifies the life that Julius has led off the track, attending to duty before taking care of himself, rising to a challenge that is both physical and spiritual, finding a way to keep moving forward even as the road bends in unexpected directions, accepting the grace of a power beyond his agency, even when that power proves more immolating than merciful. While he doesn't speak often of running, Julius Achon speaks always of a journey. And the story always starts in the same place, a village called Owake. Part 1. Owake, Uganda, 1988. It was Saturday, which meant that Julius would be spared the shame of school. He would not be hectored by a teacher demanding tuition, and thus wouldn't have to jump out a window to escape a caning. He wouldn't feel humiliated by his lack of a school blouse. He wouldn't grow lightheaded because he had nothing to eat between dawn and evening, and his guts wouldn't seize because he'd drunk out of a ditch where the cattle wallowed. On the other hand, there would be no games during recess, no joking with friends on the 3-mile walk to school, no pretty girls to watch shyly from a distance, and no moment under the mango tree when, scratching out numbers in the dirt, he suddenly recognized their order and pattern. A thrill of insight that would inevitably be wiped away by the teacher dragging his shoe over Julius's work so that the next child could take his turn with arithmetic. Saturday, so none of that. But still, Julius rose early. The Achon family, Julius was the oldest of 9 children, occupied a complex of circular huts, dried mud at the base, and dried grass woven into a roof, spread over an acre-sized clearing about a mile off the main road between the city Lira and the border with Sudan. Clansmen occupied similar clusters of huts within a 10-minute walk. Together, the huts formed the village of Owake. There was no commercial center to mark the place. Its boundaries were engraved in the memories of the village elders. The family slept inside last night because the Karamojong were not active in the area. During the time of the Karamojong, herders infamous for thieving cattle, you had to leave at night to sleep in the elephant grass. There was no resisting their savagery when they came. You could smell the Karamojong before you saw them. That sickening grease smell from the cattle fat they slathered over their naked flesh. They used to attack with bows and spears, but now they came with AK-47s. Julius once saw a friend, a classmate, a Longi boy his own age, fall like a bird from the branch of a shea nut tree when a Karamojong scout shot him. The boy landed with a sickening thud, bounced once, and then lay still and dead. At that point, Julius Achon had already seen a number of dead people, especially dead children, but they had all died from cholera or typhus or AIDS or dysentery or pneumonia, or malaria, or any number of other preventable diseases that afflicted Uganda, where 60% of the population was under the age of 20, and the life expectancy was 46. But that was the first violent death the boy had witnessed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.